Memories, I will start recording, then we can give the film as a present to Günther. So now recording has started. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, today is a great day. Today we celebrate the work of Günther Leugling, who is the leader of the Chair of Applied Mathematics II. I'm Martin Gugert and I've worked at the Chair of Applied Mathematics II from 2003 to 2019. And Wiegand Rathmann, who has also worked at the Chair of Applied Mathematics II until 2019, will support me in the presentation. Thank you, Wiegand. I'm very glad about this opportunity to recognize Günther's achievements. I'm happy that you all have joined our celebration and hope you will enjoy the program. And the first speaker is the president of our university, Joachim Hornegger, but I did not yet see him. So what can we do? We can say what a happy day again.
Can sing it,
And
Martin, until it comes.
good morning, Herzens. Do you know where Hornegger is? No.
At least he's in the office.
Ah, yeah, so
know
I
that.
hope he joins us now, yeah.
Yeah, I hope so too.
He's still working on the problems that the chancellor gave him, right?
Yeah, maybe. So, and just for those who did not know this, since 2019, I and Wiegand have moved to the Chair of Applied Analysis. That's the new Humboldt Chair, led by Enrique Zuazua, who will also give the last talk today. But before he will leave us for some time because he's attending a German course and progressing a lot in his German. So, but he will then return to give his speech. And now I see
Having
our
said that,
president. And as soon as you are ready, Achim, please share your slides. The stage is yours.
macht er denn, wenn Johannes ist auch da? Johannes ist wo? Achso, ich darf da nicht so hinstellen.
I see multiple Leugerings joining. This is kind of a multiplication process.
Oh, sorry. Did
Oh,
Ah, very good. Yeah, please, Achim. So I already announced you, and because I was sure you would be there in any minute, and now you can
I
just
already
start.
I have to say I already started, and then I noticed that nobody is hearing me. I'm sorry for that. So a warm welcome, lieber Günther. Dear colleagues, dear friends, it's a great pleasure for me to say a few words in the context of the retirement symposium at our Department of Mathematics, where you reconsider the scientific life and the scientific contributions of Günther in our math department. In our interdisciplinary research environment, unique interdisciplinary research environment we have at our FAU. Günther, and you know this, was also vice president at our university for 6 years. You also know that he was a member of the Senate before he joined the university board, and I appreciated a lot to work with Günther on various levels. There is a nice coincidence because Günther and I started our career as professors at our university in the year of 2003. So we were hired the same year, and there were just two floors in between our offices. Günther was still in the computer science building, in the 12th floor, if I remember correctly. And that time we had a Sonderforschungsbereich, a comprehensive research center 603 that was headed by my predecessor. And the DFG gave young professors that are newly hired the opportunity to come up with a research proposal in between the two evaluation phases of the Sonderforschungsbereich. And Günther and I, we had the opportunity to apply for research projects. And both teams, his team and my team, we had two separate proposals on medical image registration. And that was the day when we started to collaborate on a scientific level. And I think we had really challenging projects. And also we have generated a few cool results. And Günther's visibility within the university, not only as a manager, but also as a scientist, was very high. And it was a great honor, I think, that in the year of mathematics, Günther had the invited talk at our birthday party, the Dies Academicus, to say it in formal words, where he had the Festvortrag on mathematics. And for me, it was nice to see that he was explaining mathematics on a very intuitive level. But while explaining what he's actually doing, he was also showing medical applications out of the project that we have done together. So this had a very clear impact also on his research. Günther started in the university board as the vice president for internationalization or international affairs. Also a very challenging task. You all know that we at that time, the campus in Busan, where he was in charge of right away with first day of with the first day in office, and we have to shut it down. That was a pain to do all this, and it was hard work. And I'm very thankful and grateful to Günther that he supported me in this game. And we had a clear role assignment concerning good guy, bad guy. And you can imagine who was the bad guy and who was the good guy. Günther was always very eager to find solutions that both sides can be happy. And I was pushing in the back a lot. And I think we have had our complementary positions set up in a proper manner. And the result tells me that this was the right way of collaboration. Then he was also very much involved in the refugee problem and how to integrate refugees in our university environment. We had the Integra project. This was the first visible project within Germany. We even made it to an article in the news, in the Spiegel. So very visible to the German population. And I'm very grateful that Günther took this task and found a very, very strong solution of national visibility that was more or less also a template for all the other universities how to deal with this issue. When he had solved all the problems related to international affairs, he became vice president for research. I mean, this is a retirement symposium, so I have to see the positive things, and I'm also allowed to exaggerate a little bit. So when he solved all the problems related to international affairs, he started to look into the resource of research. He became the vice president for research. And if you just look at the numbers, what happened in his time regarding joint research project, regarding DFG funding, regarding the number of ERC grants, for instance, that we have at our university. He started a lot of activities that increased the awareness of the importance of these research funding tools that are provided by the German Research Foundation and the European Union. And today we can say that our third-party funding in terms of research funding is on a record level with 222 million euros last year in the corona year. That's fantastic. And in the competition of the research-oriented universities, I think we have increased our position, and I'm very eager to see the DFG Förderatlas in fall this year, where we are in the various disciplines. So thank you very much, Günther, for all this support and all these achievements you have made for our university, for the university board. In terms of collaboration, both scientific-wise and management-wise, it was always a pleasure to work with him. He was very focused, he was very sharp, he was also very polite, and it was always nice to discuss with him various issues and to generate solutions. So thank you very, very much. And finally, I want also to mention the Humboldt Professor track that we have. Yeah, we have had 4 Humboldt professors in a row. No other university in Germany made this, and with a total number of 7, 8 Humboldt professorships at FAU, we are number 2 in Germany regarding Humboldt professorships. And there is one Humboldt professorship that is very special, and this is the Humboldt professorship of Enrique Suazua. And I'm very convinced, dear Enrique, hi there. I'm very convinced that we would never ever have made it to win and to get Enrique for our math department and our FAU without the enthusiasm, the motivation, the passion that Günther Leugering has. And he made it possible to bring Enrique into our team that significantly strengthens our FAU. So thanks also for this record and your particular support with respect to Professor Suazua in getting the Humboldt professorship. Yeah, just looking at numbers, mathematicians get rather old. Euler, Leibniz are examples where we know that they became very old. And the question is, what makes it that many mathematicians become very old? Maybe that they retire, but they don't retire and still maintain their passion for their field. I also have learned that mathematicians tend to self-reflection, and maybe this is some kind of self-reproducing mechanism that guarantees a long life and a long productive life for mathematicians. Dear Günther, thank you so much for all the support you gave to the Department of Mathematics, for all the support you gave to our students, to young researchers, for all what you did for our university to bring it to the top list within Germany. I'm very grateful that I had you in the team for 6 years, and I would have loved to continue working with you. We have extended your contract for 3 years, so you are already 3 years over. So I'm very happy that I had the honor to work with you, to learn from you. And at FAU, we are all very grateful. I wish the symposium to be successful. I think we have exciting speakers. Wolfgang will talk about Günther and his impact on the excellence cluster and the interdisciplinary research. Enrique will also talk about his experiences in the collaboration with Günther and what type of results they have gained together. So it seems to be a extremely interesting program today. And I wish you, Günther, all the best for your future. And I hope to see you on a regular basis. And with Zoom, it's so much easier. Thank you so much and all the best.
Thank you, Achim, for the great opening statement. The next speaker, as already announced, is Wolfgang Polkert, and he will tell us about optimization for materials and process design, a personal perspective from particle technology. Please.
Lieber Günther, liebe Frau Leugering, thank you very much all for this invitation to speak here on this occasion. It's a great honor for me, and I will do my best to reflect some of the joint ideas we had with Günther, some of the experiences, and to do so, I will share my screen. And I would like to focus today. Of course, I can only in this audience speak on my own experience or start from my own experience from particle technology. Optimization is your field, Günther, and you did so much for this university's optimization, I would say, in terms of materials and process design, our broader focus, and I will reflect in particular from perspectives of my own field, particle technology. So, from the early days, I picked that picture. This is maybe a critical, maybe a skeptical mind, maybe better days, at least with respect to the hairs, still full. A few years later, we were both new at the FAU. And just to, right now, I learned from our president that also he was came to the FAU in that year. So for the FAU, at least, it was a very good year, I would say. You came from Darmstadt. I'm from Munich. And I still remember our first meeting in the Hochhaus, 11th Stock. And we had a brainstorming with colleagues from mathematics on promising topics for collaborative research. I felt, I must admit, a little bit lonely, since I could not transmit my ideas on math on particles. So there was big gaps in the way how we could did communicate, and so we tried our best to meet somewhere. But there was one guy, now he is smiling, you see, however, who understood me, as my feeling was, and we were both, Günther, convinced of the value and great value of joint collaborations. So actually, I came from my background with particles, and to introduce a little bit, particles are distributed in size, in shape, surface, structure and composition. And in a mathematical sense, you would say this is a more or less complex five-dimensional space. But so far, mostly only 1D is considered. 2D distributions are coming up and can be measured now more often, but still we are far away from a full understanding, a full exploration of the 5D space. Characterization is fundamental for understanding, and of course, for most applications. And there are two sorts of measurements. On single particles, which is sometimes very difficult, but gives, of course, a very beautiful insights, and on ensembles. And most of the measurements with particles are related to ensemble measurements. This means we have static and dynamic light scattering. We have ultrasound spectroscopy, small angle X-ray scattering, sedimentation analysis, surface characterization. So, and all have in common, which is interesting, that there is a signal at the detector, which is a superposition of signals from many particles. You see it here. You have here a laser, maybe a light source, and here you have a cuvette or a reactor where the particles are in. And this light is shining into that ensemble of particles, and light is diffracted, might be scattered, and there is some optics and a detector. So these particles might be complex in shape, they might be complex in structure, and so we have all the beauty of particle science and technology, which is in, let's say, at least in the chemical industry, comprises 60 to 70% of all products. So it's really important, but this conversion is still a problem to us. So, and with that problem, I came to the Hochhaus in the 11th Stock for size characterization. To put it in, you know, my simple way in mathematics, there is a, we are seeking the size distribution, Q0, of the particles of size X, which are superimposed, and there is a detector signal U, which we need to detect or which we can measure. But this signal vector here in this summation is often disturbed by stochastic terms, by measuring errors. And so we have to invert that. And this inversion is in your language called a Fredholm integral. It's ill-posed, and the conversion is very often not possible. So there are many techniques which are which we use in our field, for instance, Phillips-Twomey algorithm, where we use some regularization techniques to get the data out. So if you do that, which is state of the art, we see that there is a size distribution, which we use as an exemplary size distribution as an input. And then with the regularization, which we see here, you can dig out by choosing the right parameters to dampen the oscillations and the stochastic terms. We can sometimes dig out the full size distribution, but often this is not possible. And still we are aiming or we are looking for better solution. With that problem, I came to that meeting and I must admit I was disappointed because that problem seemed to be too simple for you guys in mathematics, and therefore we took up more complicated one. And that all led to finally the cluster of excellence, engineering of advanced materials. So the idea was to bridge from molecules to materials, to develop advanced materials across all the scales. And we wanted, of course, at the end to have tailor-made properties. And you see here, so that we have building blocks and these particles already, you know, these we call it patchy particles, partly coded, also were, you know, originally developed and came out from your computations by predicting some of these interesting optical properties. In terms of materials design, these building blocks are integrated into superstructures, in foams, in films, and in some sort of reactors. Here, examples from additive manufacturing. And this trumpet-like reactor is an example where FAU is now doing very great work in hydrogen technology, energy storage, that defines the shape of this reactor that you might enter with a liquid of high density, and you might come out with hydrogen as a volatile gas in some of these novel and highly interesting storage aspects of energy conversion, energy storage. So to put it in simple terms, as we did it in these early days, we speak of Lego blocks. And my son at that time, he was very small and cute. He had the dream to build maybe an airplane. Of course, the first trials were simple. We had the stones were too big and the methods were not very evolved, but we had these, you know, beautiful structures in mind. And so we went off in the year 2007 to do that in a systematic way, involving then eight disciplines at the university. That was the structure which we had. We had a platform, what we call now the cross-sectional areas. There were functional particle systems. There's nanoanalysis and microscopy. And there was multi-scale modeling and simulation. And that led also to CISC, the Central Institute of Scientific Computing. And most interesting, all these aspects here, in particular multi-scale modeling and simulation, can be applied for all these applied areas of electronic materials, optical materials, catalytic materials, lightweight materials, you might also say energy materials, you might say biomaterials, and the methodology can be transferred to many of these areas. So this multi-scale modeling and simulation idea covers many time scales and length scales, from molecules where quantum mechanics prevails, to particle systems, to more complex systems like foams, devices, reactors printed out by additive manufacturing. And so there is a coupling of many, many orders of magnitude in time and length scale. This was my way to put it, the more beautiful way came from you, Günther, with all the mathematical issues, what your field must contribute here and did contribute. No? There are different scales and key questions are related to the error estimates between the scales. There is hierarchical optimization as the systems are too complex. You need to homogenize these systems to make it still tractable. And this included from the university computer chemistry, theoretical chemistry, many aspects ranging and stretching from theoretical physics, the particle technology to macro scale engineering advices. And actually it was the first time at the FAU that it was possible with your help and your initiative to put all these disciplines under one roof. And that is, if you look to all this dispersity which we experience in the world, a unique thing that you were able to put this on a common ground. And I think the university and also the cluster, of course, is extremely thankful to you that you could achieve these tasks to bring people in that way together. You put it this way, you have a workshop with many different things. Actually, it's your picture, which you put out, digged out a long time ago, and you see how to bring this to, how this makes this machine working. This is not so easy, but you could made it. And then there were many researchers, maybe even more. The data are not too new, 8 departments, many projects, many publications with other research areas, with foreign co-authors across many scales, industrial collaboration, rigorous optimization, founding of structural things like the central institutes, and so many, many things which were came out of that. And that was a baseline where your initiative was most important and where now many other disciplines and also third-party funding, collaborative projects evolved. So we put it in the cluster when we presented the cluster in the early days. This way, usually, in our understanding, we define process variables. You do the process, you understand the structure, measure the structure, look at the properties and find out, oh my God, it's not yet perfect. So you do it again and again and again and do it many times. But the idea was, can we invert that? That means, can we start from the end, define first the desired properties, derive the structure, derive the process to get an optimized overall solution. And this paradigm, to do it in our environment is more than valid ever. I would say if you look in our now new world or existing world with all the, let's say, ecological effects and energy consumption and all this impact on the environment, would put additional boundary conditions for future research. And so the key question still is, we have some success, but this will be a further research for decades. Can we optimize properties and processes based on predictive modeling? At that time, it was a question. Today, we would say, yes, we can. There is one aspect of also aspect of process optimization. So in a reactor, a stirred tank, you have fluid mechanics, you have cooling rates, residence time distribution, temperature profiles. These might lead to some sort of particles. And there is structural optimization, for instance, in terms of optical property simulation from your lab, that we are aiming, for instance, for optical properties of these particles. So, and this is some of your data which you produced with the question, can we make particles invisible? That means, can you put an ensemble, an object into a light wave in an electromagnetic field, and can you make it invisible? This means, in simple words, that the field lines a little disturbed or as little disturbed as possible. Mathematically, It means inverting of the Maxwell equation coupled to structural optimization, though that's the electric field, goes without loss across the object. If you have a cloak, you see that the electromagnetic field moves above the object. Without a cloak, you see some disturbance and you see the interaction of the particle with with our little particles. This was very interesting in terms of particle technology. People would like sometimes to make the optical properties of particles very strong. And in other cases, for instance, sun cream, you would like to have UV absorption, but you don't want to have any optical effects on the skin, to give just one example. Then we moved on more to my field in terms of making particles. So we devised reactors together with the Fraunhofer Institute in the clean room here. And we could make beautiful, round, nice particles, 30 to 50 nanometer in size. Sometimes they are aggregated. Sometimes you can even control the shape. You can produce patchy particles, silicon germanium particles, by having this sort of reactor, two-stage reactor, where in the first reactor we produce seeds, and in the second reactor we have a growth process. This is your formulation of the problem. The mathematical system is a convection diffusion reaction system. We have some reaction kinetics, which you see here. There are mass balances. We have distributions of these particles. And the key point here is that this is a PDE, your classical field. And these systems can be very stiff, in particular if you have strong gradients for nucleation events, which are highly nonlinear. So there are initial and boundary conditions in terms of concentrations, in terms of temperatures. There are known local terms included here. And there are control variables. In that case, the mass of the feed precursor, it's called silane, silicon hydrogen molecule, which is fed into the reactor, and the temperature, which controls the reaction kinetics and the growth rates of these particles. And you would like to control then and predict and optimize the obtained size distribution, which we get out. And so you started by minimizing a functional, as you guys do usually in optimization. You define some arbitrary temperature profile, which might be quite different from a measured one. And finally, in order to get a certain size distribution, for instance, this one here on the right side around with a maximum most probable particle size around 30 nanometer, you need this temperature profile, which you calculated and predicted in order to get this size distribution. So this would be a perfect example how you can influence process conditions to produce a desired property in these terms, in terms of size distributions. Brit, sit ready. Titled the German newspaper Die Zeit a couple of years ago. Biomaterials, car parts, glasses, no problems for 3D printers. The technology gets mature, and it may reshape production technologies worldwide. There is the first US president ever printed out by 3D printing, from old days. And he funded that field by $1 billion US dollars at these times. And because he would like to boost production technologies in the United States. And so you can produce biomaterials, polymer materials, these sort of reactors. If you buy a really expensive car, you can be sure that some of these parts are produced by 3D printing. So, and this led, these ideas very early, led to the field of additive manufacturing, which was condensed in Erlangen in the SFB 814, additive manufacturing. In brief, what you do, you have a bed of powder, you distribute your powders layer by layer. Then you come finally with a laser beam, and you do selective laser beam melting of these materials in order to produce 3D structures. Yeah? And this SFP would be impossible to start without the background work in the cluster, and in particular without your optimization possibilities to design these objects in a very free way. This I took from the proposal of the project proposal C2 at these days, together with Michael Stingel. And the aim was to get to optimize the mechanical properties of some structures by your structural optimization techniques. And not only in the CRC 1814, similar, I started in the cluster also Frascal Research Trading Group, which is now led by our colleague Steinmann on fracturing of particles and of systems on projects. And many other projects were initiated by you and your techniques. And now this is a very strong aspect of our portfolio here in Erlangen, and in particular of the mass department. We also collaborated in the priority program 1253, optimization with partial differential equations, which you founded. And which you guided over 6 years. And we were involved, at least in the first funding periods, and they kicked us out because there was not enough math in our case. And we looked at the quantum dot synthesis. So you have a hot bath and a hot soap solution. You inject some solutions, and then nice particles form. And all these particles are small, a few nanometers only in size, and they all have a different color depending on size. And that effect is called quantum size effect. It's a quantum effect where the band gap opens as a function of particle size between the valence band, where the electrons are bound in coordinating orbitals, and the conduction bands, which then the electron is free, and in between there is an energy transition which depends on the molecular structure, on the energy levels of all these internal electronic states, and this is size dependent. Yeah. And the size dependency, you see then if the particles are smaller, as you see here, the blue ones are, my cursor is not moving so good. The blue ones have a blue shift. Due to the blue shift means that the wavelength is shorter, that the energy is higher, and the band gap is wider. And these particles can be formed in continuous productions, as you can see here on the right, where we are aiming to produce these particles in a continuous way, and by using inline optics, we can analyze and look at the formation of these sort of particles, which are of high added value. In the first cases, for instance, to use them in TV screens with high brilliance, are already out. So again, this is a complicated mathematical problem. It's related to Ostwald ripening. Ostwald ripening means that the particles have a very high surface. They are very small, but and they have a curvature at the surface. And this curvature leads to different solubility and the different bonding strengths. This leads to different solubility of the particles. That means a smaller particle has a higher solubility as the big ones. And as in real life, the big ones eat the small ones. And so the small ones dissolve and the big ones grow further and further. And this is a complicated problem because this ripening depends here in some ugly terms, where you have the particle size in the denominator. And this leads again to a very stiff problems. And this depends on temperature. This depends on particle size, on material properties. And we would like to control here these properties in, again, a reaction concentration transport scheme. What mathematics can do is here a beautiful example. So you developed with your colleagues and in your group a fully implicit finite volume method to very fast solve this problem. Classical solution was very tedious. It took a lot of time. It was did contain a lot of scattering, but your method was very elegant and is highly efficient and still used calculate these systems. What you can do here, you can predict the particle size evolution for different temperatures. You see here 20 centigrade or 40 centigrade. You can predict gradients if the temperature is raising fast, slow, and then fast, or if the temperature is first increased and then decreased. All these possibilities led to quantitative agreement with experimental data, which we could obtain from these results. And then another priority program to put that a step further, dynamic simulation of interconnected solids processes. This was coordinated by a colleague of mine in Hamburg, and you were finally integrated in that program. And now in that program, we didn't look only at one unit operation or one process. You looked at very complex processes. Here, an example which was studied by the colleagues in Hamburg, separation and cleaning of Hamburg harbor sludge. And you see a dozen of different models and operations need to be developed in order to being able to calculate and simulate and finally optimize such highly complex systems. So there were dynamic process models involved. There were material functions, material properties, and you did contribute to algorithms and process simulation. And here you see in a very simplified way that you have a different combination of systems which work together. There is a mass flow from one reactor to another reactor, for instance, a preparation step, a synthesis step, a separation step, and there is feedback which makes the simulation even more complicated. We looked here at microreactors, which are organized on a small lab tabletop system. There is a mixing devices, there is a reactor, there are cooling sets, and there is again feedback loops. And you were able to predict here the evolution of these products, and we were able even to optimize some of these properties. You will see in the result in a second. So, and that, and all that, taking this together, led finally to the foundation of CRC 1411, design of particulate products. This is now aiming beyond our career here at the university, beyond yours. You could not be integrated anymore. I will have to step out after the first funding period. Here we could put this in a very nice and clear way together, also with Michael Stingel here in the lead and Frauke Liers for discrete and continuous optimization. In short, in a very formal way, simplified way, we aim for a property, a color in that case, or separation efficiency for nanoparticles. There is a complex property function, dispersity as a function of size, shape, porosity, and surface. And if we start here, we might define point two and say we need to produce it. And in the process function, the dispersity, size, shape, surface evolves dynamically in the process. described by another sort of function or relation, independence of the process parameters, temperature profile, residence time. And so this way we aim to identify points 3 and 4, for instance, the right concentrations, the right temperatures for that sort of processes, which lead, of course, to the desired properties. That this is readily possible was already shown in the cluster, in the collaboration with Lanxess company, where Lukas Pflug and Michael Stingel were involved. And there is an iron oxide, a yellow pigment, which is produced at many tons a year. And this is an anisotropic particle with two different geometrical parameters, actually the rod-like particles. These areas were known for the technical pigment. So optimization did show that some of the solutions are close to the empirically found solution, but there are other areas which are completely unknown. And an example for process parameters, back to the quantum dot case. Here we have a temperature residence time profile in our reactor. The aim is particle sizes as closely controlled as 3 nanometer, 4.5 and 5.5 nanometers. And this shows the moving dots, the individual solutions of the optimization. And finally, we find out, for instance, for that case, 3 nanometer particles you can produce after 5 hours at the temperature of 20 degrees. And if you want to move to 5 or 6 nanometers, you have to increase the temperature to 45, and you need 9 hours of residence time distribution to get the same this result in a very defined way. Great results, which are here coming up based on your work here. So, in order to conclude, I would say, also maybe from the science strategy, mathematics, chemical engineering, and material science have shake hands. They can work together. This was proven on over almost 15 years. There is a convergence of methodologies. So it's a similar set of equations might for quite different applications. We have seen this for optics and mechanics. Now we see it for particle synthesis and separation. There are predictive models for particle property and process design. So you guys can design efficient numerical schemes for relevant challenges where we are desperately aiming for. You can develop rigorous mathematical optimization strategies based on predictive models. And maybe in the future, there might be a marriage of artificial intelligence and data-driven approaches. I don't know, but rumors, the promises are there. We will see how this will develop. So I believe strongly these are unique opportunities for joint venture between mathematics and engineering and basic sciences, of course. And from now on, my final slide, I hear, Günther, that you plan to do math again after your strategic tasks as vice president as FAU. That's good, of course. But please, do not start to optimize your life. Stay as you are. You are perfect as colleague and friend, as Günther. And please do not try to prove that theory. All the best to you.
Thanks a lot for this.